Reggae Just Extra with Ras Dennis.
Satta Massagana is an undeniable anthem of reggae, an ode to the African motherland that has stood the test of over 50 years since its recording by Bernard Collins, Donald Manning, and Linford Manning in 1969. Despite its popularity, the Abyssinians' debut album was pirated, causing the original artists and producer, Clive Hunt, to earn no penny.
The Abyssinians' album, Satta Massagana, was the most, I think it's the most pirated reggae album to date.
During a chat with I Never Knew TV, Clive said he almost lost his life in the process if not for Jacob Miller, who foiled the plans of the enemies. This is the story of the Abyssinians and producer Clive Hunt with Ras Dennis.
This is your home of Rastafari music, facts, and culture.
The kings of kings and the lords of lords, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah.
According to Clive Hunt, who produced Satta Massagana, he admitted to making a few crucial mistakes that hurt him in the industry. Clive stated that they had worked on the album, but while they were in the middle of the album, political violence started, gunfights became common, bombings occurred, and police were routinely shot at, causing many people to migrate out of Jamaica, and even the directors of the music company he was working with ran, and that was how he ended up working with Joe Gibbs. Upon finishing the album, Don Taylor, Bob Marley's former manager, contacted him and said that Chris Blackwell wanted to see him. So, he went to the then Sheraton Hotel to see Chris Blackwell, and after waiting for a couple of hours he stood up and was about to leave, then Don Taylor said, "No man, you are too ignorant. Come on, the boss wants to see you." So, when Chris Blackwell came out, he told him that he wanted to hear the album, and that he had spoken to the Abyssinians, but the Abyssinians had told him that he was the one who had the tapes, so he would like to give it a listen and so on. He responded in the affirmative, and they drove down to the studio and listened. When he had listened, he decided to sign the whole thing right away. Clive said he didn't agree because, first of all, it wasn't his, he was not working for himself, he was working for a company and the Abyssinians. It was his job to deliver and to recommend to the people. But the Abyssinians weren't into that. They wanted the money immediately. So, he told Chris Blackwell he couldn't do it. Chris was willing to give them good money. The same money he gave Third World and everybody. But upon leaving the hotel, he turned around and asked the engineer for $2 to enable him to take a bus home. And what happened next was, one of the people from the company contacted him and asked him to make a stamper. When he made the stamper, the guy said he must send it to someone who was going to pick it up who lives in Miami, but that he should get a test press first. For about 2 weeks, he couldn't get a test press, and then a big producer, a big man in the music world, well-respected who now has national honors, came to him and said he could assist him to get test press for him, which he agreed. He led him down to a pressing plant and gave them the stamper to make a test press on Friday evening, and it took him 2 weeks before he got it back. And when he got it back, the record was all over New York, London, everywhere. It was pirated.
Same man introduced me, him and his friends, him and pressed the album like crazy. It was all over New York, Miami, London, everywhere that people export record to.
Then Jacob Miller came to him and said, "Clive, the man them want to kill you." And he said, "Which man?" And he named one of the biggest gangsters that was very famous. Jacob Miller further said, "He's going to kill you because of the Abyssinians album." According to Clive Hunt, upon hearing that, he was never afraid, he wasn't scared. His wife wasn't scared either because she was from one of the most notorious places in Jamaica. And if anything ever happened to him, it would be a big war. So, he just decided to leave Jamaica for New York because he equally had a problem with the army. The Abyssinians' music is one of the music industry's great ironies that today, whether inside or outside of reggae circles, the Abyssinians are perhaps better known for their trio's unique harmonious roots and spiritual music. The vocal trio was originally formed in 1968 by Bernard Collins and Donald Manning. Their first song was Satta Massagana, which was strongly influenced by Carlton Manning's Happy Land. Satta Massagana is a Rastafarian hymn, sung partly in the Ethiopian Amharic language. they recruited a third vocalist, who was still at school and often unable to attend rehearsals. He was soon replaced by Donald's brother Linford Manning, who, like Donald, had previously been a member of their brother Carlton Manning's group Carlton and the Shoes. The group continued to record throughout the 1970s, and their debut album, Forward Onto Zion, was released in 1976. The follow-up, Arise, 1978, was recorded under stressful conditions with internal rivalries threatening to break up the group, and after the album's release, Collins left the band, to be eventually replaced by Carlton Manning. This lineup performed at the 1979 Reggae Sunsplash Festival, but split up the following year. Donald Manning had a brief solo career in the early 1980s in which he recorded as Donald Abyssinian. Bernard Collins launched his own version of the group in the late 1980s, with two versions of the group existing for a time. The original lineup reunited in 1998 and went on to record new material, including the singles African Princess and Swing Low and the album Reunion, although Collins was not involved in songwriting at this time. Collins left again in 1999 and released material as Bernard Collins and the Abyssinians, releasing an album the same year. The Abyssinians are credited on Slave Song from Nigerian-born British singer Sade's 2002 album, Lovers Live, which starts with a sample from the Abyssinian song African Race. On June 25, 2024, Linford Manning passed away in Florida, USA. Linford was in his late 70s. Thanks for watching, and do remember to subscribe, give it a like, and post a positive comment in the comment section below, and I'll see you again very soon for another video.
Many thanks for watching Reggae Just Extra with Ras Dennis.